Ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon. My name is Falguni Patel, and I'll be the master of ceremony for today's event. I request our director to accompany our chief guest onto the stage. Thank you, sir. I now request the director to honor our guest for the day. We have gathered here to celebrate Dr. Kurien's birth anniversary. I invite our chief guest and director to pay a floral tribute to our founder on this occasion. May I request you all to rise as a mark of respect. I call upon the director to welcome the gathering and set the tone.
Respected Chief Guest, Shri Vikram Singh Mehta, respected Mrs. Nirmala Kurien, a very, very special invitee on this occasion, respected members of the Board of Governors of IRMA, Shri R.S. Sodhi, Ms. Priyanka Singh, respected executives of GCMMF, AMUL, NDDB, IDMC, and other sister organizations, respected Dr. Ratnam, MD of AMUL Dairy, respected Dr. Prajapati, respected other dignitaries of the dais, special invitees, my faculty colleagues and staff colleagues, members of IRMA community, members of the press, my dear students of PRM and FPRM, ladies and gentlemen. Never in the history of India, to the best of my knowledge, so much has been owed by so many to one personality. A personality who relentlessly pursued his mission despite many odds. A personality who built many organizations and thus many jobs, careers, and livelihoods. A personality who demonstrated that inclusiveness, empowerment, and sustainability, the catchwords of modern era, could be achieved through cooperation rather than through subsidies long ago. A personality who had the vision and the clarity to say, I'm in the business of empowerment. Milk is just a tool in that. And a personality who had the utmost humility to say, I did not know, so I brought in people who knew and built these organizations. No description can be comprehensive about the superlatively great personality of Dr. Verghese Kurien, also known as the milkman of India and the man with the billion liter idea. His greatness genuinely defies the bounds that words in my repertoire can describe. Dr. Verghese Kurien's life story is now well known to most of us. Late Shri M.V. Kamath wrote a detailed book on Dr. Kurien titled Milkman from Anand, while the children of India are benefited by Amar Chitra Kadas, comics depicting Dr. Kurien's life in very simple fashion. There are many websites, articles and chapters in books written about him. I've heard that he was extremely familial at home. If we are lucky, we shall get to read his daughter, Srimati Nirmala Kurien's book on Dr. Kurien, on her beloved father. Nirmala ji, I urge you to write one. That will be a great honor for all of us. And we have already given you the title for the book. Though his success story is widely known now, I deem it a rare privilege granted to me to highlight a few aspects of his life that stand out as an inspiration to all of us. Dr. Kurien was a bright student at school. The headmaster of his school expressed apprehensions about his mother tongue not being Tamil. You know, he studied in a small school in a small town in Tamil Nadu called Gopi Chetty Palayam. That's quite a mouthful and a tongue twister to many of you. He stood first in Tamil in the entire class. So that's the kind of fighter he is. Now a trivia question: what would have happened if Dr. Kurien did not get into dairying? Well, each rural household in India would be using nuclear fuel, because his first passion otherwise was nuclear physics. So wherever he was, I'm sure he would have made a mark and he would have possibly done something for the rural. That's my belief. His interest was in nuclear physics and metallurgical engineering. His choice of dairy engineering at Michigan was one of reluctance, more for the sake of satisfying the Government of India's requirement. You know, he was on a Government of India scholarship, than out of any genuine interest. It's indeed a matter of curious paradox that he became possibly the best dairyman the entire world has seen. Dr. Kurien had an interesting sense of punctuality. I've heard from Dr. A.A. Chotani of NDDB 20 years ago that for any appointment, Dr. Kurien would arrive about 10 to 15 minutes early in the vicinity of the locality and then drive around for those 10 to 15 minutes. And then sharp at the time of appointment, he would enter. His reasoning was that arriving exactly on time conveys better respect to the person who has given an appointment than walking earlier, and certainly than walking late. He had a sharp sense of humor, mostly tongue in the cheek. He used to narrate to us when we were here. He used to come to the campus and talk to us. It used to be very hilarious. He had a very interesting way of narrating his anecdotes, but not any of us had the courage to laugh. We used to give a nervous grin at best. A few which I recall, I'll just state here. Once he released an advertisement that said, Air India serves Amul butter on board if they take off. Now, those were the days when Air India would cancel the flights at will without announcing. You go check in and suddenly they'll say, you will be served lunch at so-and-so place at 1 o'clock. Then in the evening you will be served snacks and dinner will be served in so-and-so place. So that's the kind of delay they were used to. Of course, it didn't go very well with the Air India Maharaja. And he was a great nationalist. He didn't like anybody saying anything about India. Somebody once said very nasty thing about Indian milk quality, and he made the government of that country to send that person to this place after he became the chairman of NDDB and made him apologize, I heard. So that kind of a very staunch nationalist he was. When he was a student, somebody apparently teased him about Indians using water instead of toilet paper, a topic which still today is greatly in discussion on Facebook. So Dr. Kurien seems to have taken a tablespoonful of butter, applied it all over his face, mush and beard, and gave him a piece of toilet paper and said, now clean it up. So that's the kind of teasing he can do if he wants, really. And right in this auditorium, when I was working in the Federation, circa 1996-97, he was sitting on the dais. And this was a time when beauty pageants were quite famous. So you had people like Sushmita Sen, Aishwarya Rai, and Priyanka Chopra, and so forth. They were all in the news. So Dr. Kurien started his speech in his usual low voice, but sharp, clear voice. Thank you all for coming to see me. You see, God has not created me beautiful. Well, that jibe was very clear to us, and we had a hearty laugh, and we were all very nervous sitting here, but after that, we eased up a little. I should mention that he had a memory that would put a modern computer to shame. I watched it in action. On that same occasion on the stage, one of our senior executives made a 45 minutes presentation on our total quality management drive in Federation. And Dr. Kurien watched the whole presentation in rapt attention. And at the end of it, he recalled each slide in the same order and gave us his insights. That was an awesome experience for us, especially given the fact that our presentation was in a very different, in a different serial order. Suddenly he was talking about Hoshin Kanri, Kaizen, and so on and so forth. And he got the whole thing beautifully and gave us in the same order his insights. And that was, we were all awestruck in that. So a man who was a great leader who inspired by his action thoroughly. He always used to tell us when we were students, always speak the truth. Because if you tell a lie, I mean, a truth actually makes functional sense. If you tell a lie, you have to remember the lie. And to cover it up later, you have to tell 9 more lies and you'll have to remember all that. And you are doomed to fail. Simple message, powerful message in the simplest language. So husbands, please note this. Dr. Kurien was awarded for his greatness so many awards. Raymond Magsaysay Award, Padma Shri, Padma Bhushan, Waitler Peace Prize, Krishi Ratna, Food Peace Prize, Distinguished Alumnus of Michigan State University, International Person of the Year by World Dairy Expo, Order of the Agricultural Merit by Ministry of Agriculture in France, and Padma Vibhushan of Government of India. A great man once wrote, "In my book, Guiding Souls, I mention Verghese Kurien as one of my sources of inspiration." And the same man goes on to write in the next paragraph, "I could never meet Mahatma Gandhi, but in Verghese Kurien, I saw the same embodiment of greatness." And this great man is none other than Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam. I don't think anything more needs to be said than this. In 1981, when he was asked after Kurien who, he responded by pointing at the IRMA students, Mr. Sodhi's batch. Each of them will be a Verghese Kurien. To me personally, Verghese Kurien is not a name. It's certainly not a person, not even a persona. I regard Verghese Kurien as a phenomenon. A phenomenon of vision, commitment, inner motivation, strategy, perseverance, resilience, integrity, and missionary zeal. With this backdrop, I'm immensely pleased to announce that now on at IRMA, we shall be celebrating 26th of November as our Founders Day. Ladies and gentlemen, it's truly humbling and emotionally choking for me in becoming the director of this great institution. It's a wonderful institution, IRMA, the brainchild and the ever blue-eyed baby of Dr. Verghese Kurien, our admirable founder. And I'm also equally humbled to stand before you on this solemn occasion on the eve of his 95th birth anniversary to welcome you all to this event. Dr. Verghese Kurien, you can see Dr. Verghese Kurien proudly wearing that Tap Me Angavastram. I'm sorry, IRMA Angavastram. I apologize. I apologize. Well, when I resigned from Tap Me, my friend who's now the director in charge, he said, "Buddy, dekho, tum to abhi ja rahe ho. You'll be out of Tap Me, but Tap Me won't be out of you." And this is the second time I make this Fox pause. The first time was in my board meeting when I was very passionately giving a plan for what I want to do for Tap Me, and Tushar Shah smiled and said, "You meant IRMA." So that slip of the tongue and not the mistake of the mind. Please forgive me for that. Dr. VK Memorial Lectures, or Verghese Kurien Memorial Lecture, is conducted annually in commemoration of the exemplary work done by him, and is generally held on his birth anniversary, the November 26th. On this day, sir, we invite famous personalities from different walks of life, those who have made significant contribution to society, to interact with students, scholars, faculty, and interested populace of Anand, to share their experience, wisdom, and vision for the future. We have always been fortunate to have had many eminent scholars and visionaries on this occasion. The first lecture was by Dr. M. S. Swaminathan in 2012. He spoke on cooperative pathway of enhancing rural livelihood and nutrition security. The second one was by Dr. V. S. Vyas, Professor Emeritus, Institute of Development Studies, Jaipur, and member Economic Advisory Committee Council to the Prime Minister of India. He delivered the second lecture in 2013 on changing contours of rural India, causes and consequences. The third lecture was delivered by Dr. Raghuram Rajan, erstwhile RBI Governor, on Indian economic and financial development. And last year, the fourth lecture was delivered by Dr. Arvind Subramaniam, Reforms on Indian Agriculture. This year, ladies and gentlemen, we are gathered to listen to an extremely eminent personality on a topic of immense relevance and importance to our nation. At a time when there is global concern about energy resources, thanks to massive use of fossil fuel by the developed nations, we in India have started viewing this aspect much more seriously than the others. The Western countries, when they were at the stage of development that we are now at, not only were indiscriminate in depleting the fossil fuel and other forms of fuel, but have done precious little to develop other forms of energy that is sustainable over time. Worse, they are busy capturing the existing source of fuel through illegitimate wars, all political, commercial, and military. While this is the brief geopolitical scenario of energy resources, the societal impact of impending fuel shortage will most likely to hit the poorest of the poor nations, and also within that, the poorest of the poorest. Not that poorest of the poor will be using fuel. Rather, they will not be in a position to fight against the mighty who would be grabbing the source of fuel, which would become increasingly scarce. Besides, in the fight for the scarce fuel, the weaker localities will be the ones that will suffer maximum, such as tribal villages in forests who will get displaced while deforestation may eliminate forests themselves. Agricultural lands may get sold off to the mighty due to escalated cost of agriculture. Needless to say, the compounded impact of this on our ecology, economy, and sociopolity is not something that appears quite palatable. That's not the kind of world that we want our children, our grandchildren to inherit from us. I'm not predicting a doomsday, but I'm forecasting a dangerous possibility if all of us live today as if it is business as usual. In this context, today's topic, attaining energy security for rural India, is extremely relevant and important as well. The topic appears deceptively simple, but in reality, it is not so. It is our good fortune that we have amongst us Shri Vikram Mehta, Executive Chairman of the think tank Brookings India and Senior Fellow of Brookings Institution. Earlier, Shri Mehta was the Chairman of Hydrocarbon Committee of the Confederation of Indian Industry and a member of its National Council. He is an independent director of several companies including Larsen & Toubro Limited, Mahindra Mahindra Limited, Vodafone India Limited and Colgate-Palmolive Limited. Shri Vikram Singh Mehta studied Bachelor's in Mathematics Honours at St. Stephen's College, Delhi University. He then obtained BA and MA Economics Honours from Magdalene College, Oxford University and a postgraduate degree in Energy Economics from the Fletcher School of Law and Diplomacy, Tufts University. Shri Mehta started his career with the Indian Administrative Service in 1978 but resigned from the services in 1980 to join Phillips Petroleum in London as a senior economist. In 1984, he returned to India to join the public sector unit company, Oil India Limited, as its advisor, strategic planning. He joined Shell International in London in 1988. He was appointed managing director of Shell Markets and Shell Chemical Companies in Egypt in 1991 and chairman of the Shell Group of Companies in India in 1994. He left Shell in October 2012. Shri Vikram Mehta is a member of various boards, the Board of Overseas of the Fletcher School of Law and Diplomacy, Tufts University, the Board of Governors of the Pandit Deendayal University of Petroleum, and the General Counsel of Mayo College. He was formerly the Chairman of the Board of Trustees of the Duke of Edinburgh's Award for India, and a member of the Board of Governors of the famous Doane School. Shri Mehta contributes regular columns in the leading national newspapers, Indian Express and Financial Express, and is the author of a large number of papers in tabloids, journals, and business magazines. Shri Mehta was the recipient of Asia's Businessman of the Year Award 2010. Ladies and gentlemen, I am pleased to present Shri Vikram Singh Mehta. Mr. Mr. Mehta, I invite you to deliver the fifth Dr. Verghese Kurien Memorial Lecture. The stage is yours.
Professor Natarajan, Mrs. Nirmala Kurien, members of the faculty of IRMA, distinguished guests, students, ladies and gentlemen, I am honored by this invitation to give this lecture. I'm honored for many reasons. I'm honored because, first and foremost, Dr. Kurien was an individual that people of my generation held up as not just an icon, but someone who tilted at windmills, someone who effected change when others gave up, someone who decided that it would be the greatest mistake to do nothing just because they felt they could do so little. He was a man that, and if anyone, that could probably solve the problem that we are going to discuss today, attaining energy security for India's rural population. He is a man who would take that challenge and provide us with solutions that would step by step, slowly but surely, lead us to that destination. So I'm greatly honored, sir, for this invitation. I'm of course honored to be the fifth speaker in a line of certainly more distinguished people than me. I'm not going to, for a moment, be immodest, but I have to accept that the people you've had on this podium before me had a much more illustrious career and were more distinguished, and certainly, probably, more knowledgeable. So, ladies and gentlemen, please accept that this is, for me personally, a great honor, and I'm humbled. Now, the topic that I've been asked to talk about Attaining Energy Security for India's Rural Population is one that requires a more precise definition. What do we mean by energy security? Most people look at that term energy security and believe that it denotes energy dependence. India is dependent on imports of oil, and it is therefore energy insecure. And in conversations that we have in our drawing rooms or amongst our friends, we will essentially, more often than not, use the term energy security as a synonym or as a means of really saying we should reduce our dependence on imports. My own definition of energy security is much broader. It, in fact, has four other elements to it. The first is reliability. The second is affordability. The third is sustainability. And the fourth is empowerment. So my definition of energy security is all about access, which is really providing supplies, making sure that we have supplies. But those supplies must be secure. They must be reliable. Those supplies must be of the right quality. Those supplies must have the right characteristics. It is no good having access to energy at 12 o'clock at night when you're fast asleep. You need energy at the right time and the right quality. Those supplies must also be sustainable. In a world that is now increasingly concerned about global warming and climate change and environmental degradation, the issue is all centered on clean energy and sustainable energy. Those supplies, those access to energy must be affordable. There's no point making energy, providing energy that you cannot afford. And finally, you must have energy, you must have control over the energy that you receive. You must be empowered enough to be able to allocate that energy, to use that energy, to distribute that energy in the way that you see best. So energy security for me, if I was to define it, is access to reliable, affordable, secure, and clean energy through institutional structures that enable the rural population to control its allocation, distribution, and usage. That is my broad definition of energy security. And so, in responding to the topic today, I'm going to actually address it in three parts. I'm going to start by giving you a sense of the energy situation confronting this country today. Where are we today with regard to energy? I'm going to then move on and sketch for you the underlying forces that are defining the future of energy. Now, in doing that, I'm going to talk about forces that might not be relevant to India today. They might not appear to be relevant to our rural population today. But I am deliberately putting it on the table. I'm deliberately pushing it towards you because I believe they will be relevant to India and in particular to the rural population in the future. So the second part of my talk today is going to be about the underlying forces that define the future of energy, that determine the future course of energy, that will influence the nature of energy. And in the third part of my talk, I will offer some specific suggestions on how India's rural population can achieve energy security as defined by me just now. So let me start by giving you a sense of what is the current situation of India's energy crisis. What is the nature of India's energy crisis? I use the word crisis deliberately. It is a crisis. And the reason it is a crisis is because of three factors, which can be summarized in three short sentences. The demand for energy is surging. The supply of energy is not keeping pace with the demand. And our environment is under stress. These three sentences capture the essence of our energy crisis. Demand for energy is surging for many reasons. But just to give you a statistical backdrop, demand in India for energy has doubled over the last 10 years because it has been increasing at a compound rate of 6.5% per annum. And it is projected to double in the next 10 years. And by 2030, India's demand for energy is going to account for 30% of global energy demand. And India will be the first, if not the second, if not the first, or the second largest, if not the largest consumer of energy in the world, even more so than China. That is if our demand projections continue to increase at the rate that they have increased over the last 10 years. The major component of our energy demand is coal. It accounts for approximately 45% of our total energy consumption basket. Then comes oil, or oil and gas, which accounts for about 35%, and the balance 25% or 30% is non-commercial fuels. Now these numbers vary depending on which particular statistic you look at, but broadly speaking, the message that I think I want to just pass on here is that our demand is increasing at the fastest rate of any country in the world today. We are a fossil fuel-based economy, but a large part of our energy basket is accounted for by non-commercial fuels like fuel wood and biogas, dung and so on. Now, supplies are not keeping pace with demand. And the reason supplies have not been keeping pace with demand is because there have been no major discoveries since Mumbai High offshore oil discovery in the mid-60s, developed in the early 70s. And then a couple of discoveries in Rajasthan and in the offshore Krishna Godavari basin. But in general, there have been small discoveries, but in general, the supplies of oil and gas have simply not been keeping pace with the demand increase. Also, when we look at coal production, that also has slipped dramatically. Coal production has increased by approximately 4.5% per annum. But in the last 5 or 6 years, it took a significant dip because of what in Delhi or around the country is called Coalgate, the scandal that accompanied the auction of coal mines. All the licenses that were issued by the government between 2004 and 2011 were cancelled by the Supreme Court because of the nexus between the businessmen and the politicians. And as a result of that, the coal production also fell quite dramatically. Now, the environment we don't really need to describe the denudation of our environment. You have to go to Delhi, it is the most polluted city in the world today. I have a home in a house, in a place called Binsar. It's a forest sanctuary and a wildlife sanctuary in the Himalayan foothills or the Kumaon foothills. And I've been going there for the last 35 years. And over these years, every year I go there, and a lot has changed, and some things have not changed, and some things have really got worse. So what has changed over the last 35 years as I've driven up to my home? Well, earlier the roads were not tarred, there was no tarmac road leading up to my house, I had to walk up to my house. Today the roads have been tarred, I can drive up to my house. Earlier, most of the roofs of the villagers were thatched. Today, they are now roofed with solid beams. And of course, you see a lot more motorized traffic. A lot of the villagers have scooters and so on. And everyone has a mobile phone. So that is the change that's taking place over the last so many years. But what has not changed? This place, Binsar, had no electricity 35 years ago. It has no electricity today. There is no, every evening when the sun sets, I can sit out on my veranda and I look down and I see pinpricks of light. And this light is from kerosene lamps. Most of the kerosene has been bought on the black market. There is no grid electricity. LPG cylinders are scarcely available. There was one windmill that was working in that region, and that also is packed up because there was no maintenance. So the people are without electricity, they've been without electricity for the last 35 years, they're still without electricity. And what has got worse? Well, the environment has got worse. Every year, when you enter this forest, you feel sadness at the fact that the forest cover has got denuded. You feel sad because you can no longer, and I don't want to sound romantic, but I really mean it, you no longer can smell the pine as strongly as you could earlier. The water, there were streams of water, most of them have dried up. I used to have a pipe coming into my house to give me running water, that doesn't exist anymore. I've had to collect water in water tanks. So the fact of the matter is, here is one personal anecdotal example of the essence of our energy crisis. The demand for energy is increasing. The supply just simply has not kept pace. The villagers have no supply, and the environment has been degraded. Now, why has this happened? And there are really three reasons for the current energy crisis. And I'm simplifying because I don't have the time, all the time to talk about just one aspect of my topic. Or rather, I don't have the time to talk about an aspect which could take up most of my time. The reason why there is a crisis today in the country is because of population, prosperity, and policy. You can say the three P's. Now, I don't have to elaborate on the issue of population. We are a country of 1.3 billion people. Our per capita consumption of energy is 27% of the average of the world. It's 41% of the average of China, and it's only 6% of the average per capita consumption of the United States. So with this large population and this low base of consumption, our energy demand will inevitably grow. So population is a factor for the increase in the demand for energy. Prosperity is the second reason for our crisis. Our economy has quintupled over the last 15 years. In 20 years, let's say. In 1992, our GDP in 2009 numbers or 2009 dollars, was about $350 billion. Today, our GDP is in excess of $2 trillion. But That in itself is not the reason for the increase. The reason for the increase is because our economy has moved from a low energy intensive trajectory to a relatively higher energy intensive trajectory. Agriculture, which accounted for more than 30% of our GDP not many years back, accounts for only 18% of our GDP today. And agriculture is a relatively less energy intensive sector of our economy. Manufacturing, on the other hand, which accounts for about 25% of our GDP, takes up 90% of our coal production. It absorbs one third of the electricity that we produce. And as all of you know, our current economic policy is to encourage manufacturing. Make in India is about creating a manufacturing hub in India. So we are now embarked on a trajectory, on a pathway that is relatively energy intensive. And that is a consequence of the economic change that has come about because of increasing prosperity. A third factor that explains maybe the reason for increasing demand is the changing demography and social makeup of our population. The median age of our population is today 23. Most of the young are people with aspiration. Most of the people, many of you, have an aspiration to make sure that your lives are better than the lives of your parents, that the future is better than the present. And for many, that aspiration sometimes converts to very tangible economic benefits. People want to trade up from riding a cycle to driving a two-wheeler to maybe owning a Tata Nano. This is a metaphoric meaning a car, a cheap car. But there is this aspiration to go from a non-motorized vehicle to a motorized vehicle. And that aspiration is also driving the demand for energy. So these are three, broadly speaking, factors that have led to the increase in demand: population and prosperity, and within prosperity, the shift in our economic trajectory and the shift or the change in our demographic and social profile. But perhaps the most important explanatory factor to explain our current energy crisis is policy. We have had a government, not the present government, not the previous government, but mostly all governments since 1947, that have seen energy to be a political commodity. They have priced energy at less than cost for good political reasons. But in the process of subsidizing petrol or diesel or LPG or kerosene or electricity, what have they actually achieved? They have achieved wasteful consumption. They have achieved the dieselization of our economy. They have allowed for the adulteration of the fuel that has polluted our air. Why adulteration? Because if the price of kerosene is less than the price of diesel, and if the margin that a dealer is getting is fixed, there is an incentive for the dealer to spike kerosene into the diesel and sell it to the consumer. And for many, many years, all of us were actually going to petrol station and buying adulterated fuel. So much so that companies had to put up posters to say, come and buy from us, it is clean for sure, or pure for sure. That was the banner, pure for sure. So policy has been a very major factor. And it's not just the policy of subsidization. It's also the policy that did not focus on demand management. Most of the governments, most of our government ministries focused on increasing the supply of energy from our domestic resource base. And they ignored the fact that you can actually save energy by putting pressure on demand, by conserving demand, by becoming more fuel efficient in the usage of energy. So there was no focus on that aspect as well. There was no focus on demand management. On the supply side, the policy also suffered because government was suspicious of the private sector. They did not want the private sector to explore for oil or for gas. They did not want the private sector to be involved in the production of coal. And as a result of that, all the effort to produce oil, gas, or coal was concentrated in the hands of the public sector. Now, I worked for the public sector, I worked for the government, and I have great admiration for the public sector. But the problem is that the public sector in India is controlled by the bureaucrats who don't understand how to run companies, especially companies that are technical in nature. I also worked very shortly in the Ministry of Petroleum for 5 years, in fact, not very shortly, for four. So I know how intrusive the bureaucracy is. I know what it is when the secretary to the government of India or the joint secretary to the government of India picks up the phone and calls the chairman of a 20,000, 30,000, 40,000 crore company every week just to come and have a half an hour meeting in Delhi. It completely ruins the way that the public sector functions. Now, under that kind of a system, the public sector was never going to be able to harness the indigenous resources of our hydrocarbon base. It was never going to be able to fully exploit the resources that we have in our country. It is because of this intrusive management or this intrusive interference in the management of the public sector that even today, the intensity of oil exploration in our country is amongst the lowest in the world. We have 26 sedimentary basins in the world, meaning these geological areas that have the potential to contain oil and gas. Only 22% of the sedimentary basins have been intensively explored. So there has been a kind of a very ambivalent approach to the private sector. Most of the government bureaucrats have been suspicious of the private sector until fairly recently. But over the past so many 4 or 5 decades, the legacy of a state-controlled public sector certainly impacted the rate of growth of development of domestic supplies of oil, gas, and coal. Of course, in the coal, our supplies suffered because of corruption. It suffered because of labor unions. It suffered because of poor infrastructure. Most of the mines that we have are in Bihar, Jharkhand, Chhattisgarh, and most of the consumption is 1,000 miles away. If you don't have a proper rail link, you're not going to be able to bring the coal from the mines to the point of consumption. Or if you can bring it, it will be very costly. Now, so that was, the reason why demand was moving up, supply was moving down. population, prosperity, and policy. And the consequence of surging demand and stagnating supply was a stressed environment. As I've already explained, people who don't have access to commercial sources of fuel, like LPG or kerosene, on a regular basis, on a reliable basis, on a secure basis, they are driven to cut the forests. They are driven to exploit the water tables. People who are encouraged or incentivized to adulterate the fuel will inevitably lead or result in air pollution. So our environment has been degraded because of this very this factor of policy that has been part of the populist platform of succeeding governments. So I really want to just say that is where we are. So now the question really is, where are we headed? And what is the future of our energy situation? Now, in order to answer that question, I think it is very important to try and understand the forces that are currently impacting the energy sector in general. And there are two forces that I want to talk about in some detail. One is technology, and the other is global warming. These are the two forces that are going to impact the future shape of the energy profile globally and also in India. I'm sure all of you have heard of Moore's Law. Moore's Law said that computing power will double every 18 to 24 months. Now imagine, just imagine, that you are driving a car. And you drive that car for 5 miles an hour in the first minute, 10 miles an hour in the second minute, and you double the speed every minute thereafter. So in the first minute, at 5 miles an hour, you will have covered 450 feet. In the second minute, at 10 miles an hour, you'd have gone 1,700 feet. In the fifth minute, at 80 miles an hour, you'd have gone slightly more than a mile. Now imagine that you double this speed 27 times. Your speed would be 617 million miles an hour. And you could reach Mars in 5 minutes. Now the reason I'm telling you 27 minutes is because the integrated circuit was first created in 1958. And technology has expanded 27 times since then. The nature of technological explosion over the last so many years is been phenomenal. And the example I'm giving you is just to illustrate the fundamental point that technology is moving, is changing the nature of the world in which we live. And you're aware of it, internet, cell phones, etc., etc. But in the energy field as well, it is going to fundamentally change the way that we consume energy, the way we relate to energy. It's going to fundamentally change the sources of energy. It's going to make the whole energy picture dramatically different from what we see today. The question really is, when will that happen? But the point I want to just leave with you for the moment, and I'll come back to it, is technology will inevitably change the nature of the energy situation facing the rural population, facing the urban population in the coming years. There's climate change is the second very dramatic development. And here, I think you have to ignore, for the moment at least, President Trump, President-elect Trump. I hope we can ignore him totally, even when he becomes president, at least as regards this issue. But he is a man who still thinks that climate change or global warming is the greatest hoax perpetrated on mankind by the scientific community. He said it like that. He's already said that he wants to pull America out of the Paris Agreement. Now, I'm going to put him aside for the purpose of this conversation or this talk. And I'm going to say to you that there is no dissonant message with regard to global warming. There is now a worldwide consensus that mankind has led to the warming of the planet, and that if something is not done to arrest global warming, we will all face a catastrophe. India has a coastline of 7,000 kilometers. 150 million fishermen and others live on that coastline. If nothing is done to contain global warming, the sea levels will rise and these people will be severely affected. We cannot ignore it. Now, the point I guess I just want to make is that there is a convergence here between technology and climate change. But there's also a third factor that's going to influence the nature of our energy profile. And that has to do with the attitude of what the Western world calls Generation X or Generation Y. Most of the people sitting here are in that generation or of that generation. The millennials is another way of putting it. People who were born between, I think, 1980 and 1985 or something, who are in age group 20 to 30. But all of you, you have a very different approach, they say, towards the world, a very different attitude towards the world than people like me. Let me give you an example of why this demographic change, this social change, is going to be impactful when we talk about energy. I'll illustrate this with something that the Pentagon did, and then I'll come back to the point I want to make. About 8-9 years ago, the US Defense Department decided to organize a race. And this was a race across the desert in California, the Mojave Desert in California. And they invited scientists who were working on robotic vehicles, driverless vehicles, to race their cars against each other. And they offered a prize of $1 million to the car, to the scientist, that was able to complete the full course of 150 miles. This first race, no one completed the race. No car, in fact, went beyond even 10 miles. They all broke down. The Pentagon didn't give up. They decided that they were going to actually have another race. So a year later, they introduced another race. This time, it was not across the desert. It was across mountain passes with hairpin turns and tunnels and everything else like that. Very difficult. The prize money was raised to $2 million. 40 cars entered the race. 15 completed the race. It was as a result of that success that the chairman of Google, a man called Sergey Brin, decided to hire all these scientists from the Pentagon and start work on what is called
autonomous vehicles or driverless vehicles. And so today, in California, you will now find cars in the pilot phase, which are actually moving along the roads without drivers. The reason I give you this example is because if you were to think about it, if you were to add this example of technological change to the idea of shared mobility, which is what Uber and Ola have introduced, it might well change the way that the young, that is you, look at the whole idea of owning a car. You might say that cars are no longer something that I want to own because I have access to it through so many different means. You know, I can use Uber, and I have public transport. Cars are a commodity. They're not a luxury. Cars are a waste. 90% of the time, the car is parked in my garage or on the roadside. I only use it for 10% of the time. It's the most wasteful asset that you can imagine. Why do I want to spend all this money? So if all of you, the young, start thinking like this, it's going to change the whole demand profile for fuel. Because remember, 60% of oil is used for transportation. Now, technology is going, is the impact of technology, and is going to possibly change the way that the young or the millennials approach conventional commodities, conventional usages. And if that happens, the whole attitude towards consumption basket, consumption of energy will change. The point I want to just make is that there is now a revolution taking place in the way that people are going to use energy. And if on top of this technological revolution, all of you, the young, decide to reject dirty fuel, if you reject the idea that you want to use oil and gas because it pollutes the atmosphere, it's going to be quite revolutionary. So the important thing to note here is that there is now a change in the offing, a change around the corner that is driven by technology, is driven by global warming, and is driven by behavioral attitudinal change. Now I give you this example because I am now going to sort of do some of my own. This is my own thinking about the future. So if I use this, if I think that today we are at the cusp of a change, we are at a crossroad, then the question that I ask myself, especially when it comes to the fundamental question of attaining energy security for the rural population, the question then is, what is the direction in which this population is going to go? And over what time period? Clearly, if we just followed the linear path, if we continue to go down the path that we have gone down for the last 40 years, then the demand for energy amongst all of us and the rural population will be focused on fossil fuels. But there is another path that I've just described, which is off the beaten track, which is driven by technology, and which is going to be influenced by changes in the price of alternatives to fossil fuel. So solar, wind, biogas. Now, if technology actually leads to the collapse in the cost of renewable energy, if technology allows the rural population to control the source of energy, because it is now being developed in their own area through distributed models, if technology allows them to actually create partnerships whereby they are the providers of energy and the consumers of energy, then you have a very different model from the one that we have adopted over the last 40 years. This is where our solution lies. The solution for attaining energy security, as I defined it, lies in the development of distributed, dispersed, clean energy that is affordable, that is provided or produced by the people themselves, that is consumed by the people themselves, and that is then sold by the people themselves. And it is possible. And I'll give you examples where this is happening. But before I do that, let me emphasize that this model that I'm talking about is not going to change. It's not going to happen overnight. It's not going to happen, you know, it may be a figment of my imagination, because today, right now, all of you who are working in villages know that no farmer, no villager is actually thinking about solar or thinking about wind. They can't afford it. They're looking to acquire just that simple, they want that electricity to irrigate their fields. They want that electricity to light their homes, to heat their homes, to cook their food. They want that. They want it at a price. And they want it at the right time. That's what they're looking for right now. So the first solution that we have to actually look at is how do we meet the requirements of the rural population today? Not tomorrow, not in the future, but today. And in order to do that, we have to first answer the questions that get raised because of the crisis that we have created for ourselves over the last 50 years. And in that crisis, we all know that one of the biggest problems is the fact that our distribution companies for electricity are all bankrupt. That even though today there is now a surplus of coal being produced, we still, and even though we have enough generating capacity of electricity, there is a shortage of electricity in the villages. The government of India has produced a statistic which is, to my mind, fascinating. It says that there are 567,000 villages in India. Of those 567,000 villages, 18,400 only are not electrified, meaning the rest are electrified. And that this year, by the end of 2016, 14,000 of those 18,000 will get electricity, and that the balance 4,000 villages will receive electricity off the grid. Maneke, they'll get it from solar or wind or something else, bio. But, you know, I don't have to say it to you. All of you know that there must be at least 70 million to 80 million, 70 crores to 80 crore households. That means between 350 to 400 million people who do not have access to electricity. So where is this, what is this discrepancy? Why this discrepancy between a government-produced statistic and the reality on the ground? Well, I'll tell you what the reason is. The reason is simply to do with definitions. You know what is defined as an electrified village? And a village is deemed to be electrified if 10% of the households are electrified in that village. It is deemed to be electrified if the basic infrastructure relating to distribution, to transformers and distribution have been installed. And in some states, it is deemed to be electrified if one Dalit household has electricity. Now, you know, this is you're playing with people's lives when you start making statistics like this. Because what that does is you can then deny yourself the reality. And then you deny the importance of actually solving the basic problem. So when we address the short-term issue, short could be 5 years, 10 years, but let's just say, when you address the immediate issue of how do we attain energy security for the rural population today, You have to first ask the question, how do you get the distribution companies to start selling electricity and not hoarding electricity? How do you revitalize the various state electricity boards? There are solutions here. In this state, Gujarat State Electricity Board actually was running a huge loss until 2001. And then they changed the Gujarat Electricity Board, they restructured it, and they also put in two feeder lines. One feeder line was to provide power for irrigation, and another feeder line was to provide power to the households. The feeder line for irrigation was subsidized. The power to irrigation was subsidized. The power to the household, the farmer was required to pay market price. And the farmer was perfectly okay because the government guaranteed access to power at the right time, right quality. And within 5 years, GEB posted a profit of 205 crores on a revenue of 7,000 crores. Same thing they did in Madhya Pradesh. There are solutions. Now, these accounts could be fudged. I'm not saying that the Gujarat State Electricity Board numbers that I've quoted are the correct numbers. That's what I've read in their balance sheet. But the fact of the matter is that there is a way of trying to solve the problem. The government of India today has introduced what's called the Uday scheme. This is another way of approaching it. But first step in trying to get your security problem sorted out for the rural population is you've got to solve the problem with the distribution companies. The second step is you've got to connect the villages with infrastructure. So again, Gujarat is a good example. Gujarat actually put pipelines, gas pipelines, and connected all the villages of Gujarat, or most of the villages of Gujarat. So today, Gujarat villages actually have access to pipe gas. But there is no other state in this country that has done the same thing. There is no other state that has an intrastate gas pipeline. So no other state can access gas to their homes, to their households. Now, gas is a fuel for the midterm. It's a bridge fuel. It's a fuel that takes us from coal-based economy to, hopefully, a clean economy. And we have to actually, we have to now invest in the infrastructure for gas. That is pipelines. We have to talk about pricing of gas so that it is affordable. So that's the second thing that we have to do. Both of these steps must be taken now. And we have to recognize a very simple fact, that it takes a long time to transform a country's infrastructure. So today, our infrastructure, energy infrastructure, is based on fossil fuels. It will take many years before we can transform this infrastructure to run our economy on non-fossil fuels, non-coal, non-oil, non-gas. You know, Edison, Thomas Edison, he illuminated the southern half of New York City with his electric power, his light, in 1885. You know, it took the factories in America another 40 years to shift from steam power to electric power. And the reason it took them 40 years to make that shift was because the factories were all designed to only use steam power. So most of these factories had to be either rebuilt or completely redesigned from within, from inside. The same thing is going to happen to all these countries that are now looking to shift away from the use of oil and gas. They're going to have to change the entire energy infrastructure. And it's going to take a long time. But the first steps can be made now. And making that first step, you have to start by putting in an infrastructure that allows you to move from oil and coal to gas. So that's why As a second suggestion, I would say you have to now invest in the pipeline infrastructure to connect our villages. Then you look forward and you say, well, that in itself, the restructuring of our distribution companies, our electricity boards, and the investment in pipeline infrastructure, these two initiatives, they only address the component of access and maybe affordability, if you get the pricing right, and maybe even quality. But they do not address the question of sustainability or empowerment, which are the two other very fundamental things that I think we need to focus on when we're talking about attaining energy security for the rural population. As I said at the very start of my talk, it's not a question about access only, it's not a question about quality, it's not just a question of affordability, it's a question of sustainability, and it's a question of do the people, do the villages have control over the energy source that they use? So, sustainability is all about clean energy. And clean energy is all about renewables and maybe new technologies. So we today are looking at solar and wind and bio. And as I said earlier, technology has really pushed the price point, the cost structure of these renewables down. So 4 years, 5 years ago, and this is a figure for the US, and I can give you figures for India as well, but just to give you an illustration. 5 years ago, it would cost you between 7 cents, take this as a, you know, US illustrative, 7 cents to, sorry, 3 cents to 7 cents to generate 1 kilowatt hour of electricity from solar. And maybe, now it costs you 3 to 7 cents to generate 1 kilowatt hour from solar and 7 to 8 cents to generate 1 kilowatt hour from wind. Now, if you were to compare that price to oil, which is currently selling at $50 a barrel, and you would actually find that it will cost you 14 cents, that is twice the price, to generate electricity from oil. That is, oil at $50 leads to a tariff, a price of 14 cents a kilowatt hour, wind at 7 cents, and solar at 8 cents. The point that I want to make is that the technology has already reduced the cost of turbines, inverters, solar panels so sharply that they are now competitive against oil. It's not a question of cost. It's a question of capital. It's a question of infrastructure. The people in India can still not afford to buy a solar panel. They cannot afford to go out there and invest in the upfront cost of creating a solar lighting system or of putting up a windmill. They don't have that kind of cash. So the solution now that we have to look at is one that actually addresses the problem of working capital, finance, and the problem of distribution, and the problem of income generation. So when we talk about clean energy for rural population, we will need to look at a model that is a collaborative model, that is a partnership model. A model where you actually bring the technical specialist who understands how to build a solar plant in partnership with a social entrepreneur, a finance company or a social entrepreneur that has the money and is prepared to actually provide the funds in partnership with the local community, the villager who knows how, who knows what the demand is, who is also prepared maybe to look after the facility, and who will generate income by selling the energy to the other villagers, and in partnership with government, because government cannot, you cannot do without government. So it's a quadrilateral partnership that I'm looking at in order to actually attain energy security. A private sector that is going to provide low-cost funds. A public sector that is government that will provide the enabling environment, the regulatory environment. The village community that is the beneficiary, but also will generate income from access to that energy source by selling it to other people. And the technical person, the technical specialist who has access to the technology, whether it's wind technology or solar technology or what or whatever. Now, there are examples of all this. You know, there's a company called, there's an initiative it's called MCOPA. MCOPA is an initiative where you have a solar company, which is in partnership with the national telecommunications telecom company, and the purpose is the solar company will generate solar energy. The telecom company will provide the credit, the platform for the villager who buys the solar to actually pay, but he will also provide credit for payment so that you don't have to pay immediately, you pay over a period of time. So you have, in the process, a three-way arrangement whereby you're actually creating solar energy. It's a commercial relationship, so you're charging the villager a commercial price, but you're providing him access to credit so that he does not have to pay immediately. And you're doing this by putting these three partners together. You have a company now in India called Dharma, which is looking at putting in all the supply chain, that is all the various sort of inputs required to bring clean energy to the village. So it's a supply chain. It's not actually the final product, but this company is only going to actually look for making sure that all the various inputs that are required to go in to creating that final product are also available. And here again, the partnership is between government, between this entity, the private company, and the villagers. So here are some possible solutions that I think you all have to look at. And that's how I am seeing myself go. It's a short term, you have to create the infrastructure. Medium term, you have to look for solutions that are more of a partnership, or more in the nature of a partnership. Anyway, let me now bring my conversation to talk to an end, just let me just say a few things that pull all this together. Firstly, energy is a subject that sits at the heart of every decision maker's deepest dilemmas. A politician has to decide whether he is going to go for growth, economic growth, or whether he is going to protect the environment. That's a dilemma. A decision maker has to decide, am I going to actually focus on self-reliance, independence, you know, I'm going to just look at harnessing my indigenous hydrocarbon reserves. At the same time, how can I keep my borders open? How can I be part of a more globalized world? There are deep dilemmas, and it's not easy to resolve these dilemmas in a democracy. In a democracy, the politician has to worry about, might say,
balancing good politics and good economics. More often than not, the two just do not, cannot share the same space. And when push comes to shove, good economics is always pushed aside. And that's what's been the case for so many years. It's been populist politics that has determined really the nature of our energy policy. Now, I think that we have come to the point, and this is a suggestion that I would make, which addresses this, but it goes beyond this topic. I would really like the government of India to legislate a new bill. And that bill, I would say, is the Energy Responsibility and Security Act. And I would like that bill to be legislated because today, whilst we have an energy crisis in the country, we do not have an energy policy. We have many, many different government entities that are dealing with energy, but we don't have one single ministry or one single minister that is responsible for energy, the totality of energy, oil, gas, coal, biofuels, renewables, nuclear, nothing, not one person. The Prime Minister, of course, is there, but he's not the person. Below him, there's no one. So we can talk about energy till the cows come home, but we will never actually achieve energy security unless there's someone in the government of India who is able to take charge of the crisis of energy that confronts our country and actually deliver an energy policy that interlinks, you know, the implications of energy on water, on food, on environment, on our infrastructure, on our society in general, and creates an integrated energy, holistic energy story for the country, an energy policy for the country. And that's why I would suggest that we legislate an Energy Responsibility and Security Act. I would also suggest that we create a department in the Prime Minister's office, which is chaired by or headed by a minister of cabinet rank, who would be responsible for energy resources and energy security. Now, that doesn't mean that we change the existing structure. I don't want to, you know, suggest that. But I do say that we need, as I say, one person who is now going to be able to act as the coordinator for all energy-related issues. And I would say you put that person under the immediate charge of the Prime Minister. You should put him in the Prime Minister's office. And that individual and that department should be focused on, again, integrating energy policy. You focus on technology. You focus on streamlining the regulatory mechanisms. And it should be also responsible for communication. How many of us actually ever hear anyone talk to us about the intricacies, about the complexities, the nuances of energy? And yet we are the ones who are the consumers. We are the ones who sometimes suffer the consequences of poorly established, poorly implemented energy policy. So I would say that communication is also, or should also be, part of the remit of this department. Let me just finish by quoting from something that Dr. Kurien said, and I think it's very apt, and I do feel that it's reflective of the man. It's also reflective of the possibilities, the potentialities of actually attaining energy security. And what he said is that all the tools are with us in our hands to effect the transformation of our predominantly rural society. Never has an elite such an opportunity. And I really believe that is hitting at the crux of the issue. We have an opportunity to attain energy security for our rural population. We have it because the tools are in our hand. Technology has offered us a solution. the people have made themselves ready to accept that solution. The private sector is now willing to partner in the conceptualization and in the implementation of those solutions. The government has been recognized and is recognizing itself as the key enabler for such solutions. The tools are available. Someone has to pull it together, and then we will be able to attain energy security for our population. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. In fact, your speech was really insightful. You provided us the definition, and obviously you walked us through the reasons for crisis, some of the factors that has led to the increase in demand, the forces that are going to shape the future of energy, and also the steps for, you know, increase in energy security. Most importantly, you've emphasized the need for creation of infrastructure, and especially on collaborative models, the quadrilateral partnerships, and the need for legislation. After hearing, listening to an insightful speech, I think many of you would be interested to have some of your questions answered. We'll open the floor for discussions, and we'll be only taking 3 questions. So anybody, please go ahead.
Sir, I need to know, like, what is your take on nuclear fuel?
Nuclear fuel is, at one level, certainly offers a real possibility for enhancing of our energy supply situation. But at another level, you know, the public response to nuclear has been very constraining, and there's also the cost factor. So today the government has about 5,000 gigawatts of nuclear, and the plan was to create 20,000 gigawatts. But my sense is that it will not increase, it will at best go to about 10,000, which is really relating to the completion of the existing reactors under construction. And the reason is because of public protest and also cost. So I'm not seeing nuclear fuel as a major contributor to our energy situation.
Sir, you have suggested a solution to us not to buy cars or motor vehicles, and rather than that, hire Ola or Uber. If you are hiring these motor vehicles for each and every necessity, how it reduces the fuel consumption? It may reduce the traffic, but how it reduces the fuel consumption? If we are hiring the Ola or Uber for all reasons, we use the our own car. And another clarification we want to make is, in that quadrilateral model, the collaborative model, what is, if the villagers have all the right to control it, allocate it, and sell it, what is the interest of private party or the firm?
Very, very good. So on the first question, if you, today all of you buy cars and 90% of those cars are parked somewhere, you know, then it is using both, of course, space, which is scarce, you know, and secondly, it is inefficient because it's not being utilized. Now tomorrow, if you decide to adopt the shared mobility model, which is the Ola model or the Uber model, then of the people here, maybe only 50% will buy cars. Okay, so there will be a decline in the number of cars being purchased. That's number one. Okay, it's just that the likelihood is that there will be fewer cars purchased because people will now be sharing cars rather than owning cars for themselves. So the owner-operator model will now shift to a shared mobility model, and that will lead to a reduction in the number of cars owned by individuals. So that's one reason why consumption might fall. And the second is that, you know, you will be able to release value and by using
all the land or the space that's been freed up, because you're not actually using it for parking or you're not using it for garages, you'll use that to generate more value, and that in turn will hopefully go towards creation of an alternative, a more competitive energy, cleaner energy alternative. But the consumption of fuel will come down only because the ownership of cars, the number of cars that are owned will come down. That's the only, the explanation that I'd give to you for that. As far as the collaborative model is concerned, the way that the private sector could make money is, in some senses, it's very much like the model that you were talking about today, where you are not looking for maximizing the margin. You're looking to actually generate a positive margin by collaborating with the local community who are paying a commercial price. But your revenue model is based on scaling up, not on maximization of the per unit cost or the per unit margin, but in terms of scaling. And if you were to actually have a collaborative model where you were in partnership with the village community who are sharing maybe the income that they're generating with you, or where you are acquiring a certain income through the royalties that you might charge for the technology that you provide, then it could become a robust economic proposition. But these are all, every particular situation has to be looked at case by case. I can give you one specific example where it has turned out to be profitable, which is the example of clean cook stoves. This company Envirofit, in fact, it was started when I was with Shell, and the model was that Shell would provide money. We partnered with a company that had clean cook stoves technology, and we brought in the village community. And the idea was that the villagers would actually market the cook stoves at a price that we set, and they would share in the income. Initially, when Shell was involved, it was seen as a prototype pilot project, and it was not for, we did not intend to make money. But the idea was that after 3 years, we'll either close that whole thing down or it'll be converted into a commercial enterprise. Today, it's actually it's a standalone company generating significant profits because of the number of stoves that it's selling every month to the Indian villages. And it's sharing, the profit is shared with the people who are selling it in the villages. Okay.
Hello, sir. My question is that in the COP Paris conference, INDC contribution of India has committed to have its 40% of energy demand meeting from non-fossil fuel-based energy resources, most of which are going to come from solar power and wind power. But the main problem with this source of energy is that these energy sources are intermediate in nature. Like we can have solar power only when there is sunshine, or wind power when only there is a wind blow. So there is a problem of storing that energy in. So are there any technological interventions that are going to help us in that, to achieving that target of 40%?
Another very important question. So the whole area of renewable energy requires us to solve two problems, many problems, but let's say two in particular. One is the issue related to storage, and the other is related to infrastructure. So there's a lot of work going on right now in trying to improve the battery, the technology related to batteries, okay? And unless and until we are able to, we meaning the world, is able to solve the technology of storage, the whole area of renewables is going to be a challenge. But the reason I am optimistic is for the reasons I explained in my talk. I believe that Moore's law makes it inevitable that, you know, the challenge of storage will be solved, will be overcome. But that is the one fundamental issue that is holding back the scaling up of let's say
ideas like scaling up of products like electric vehicles is to do with storage. Second is on the issue of intermittent flows of molecules. Now our grid is not capable, the existing grid that we have is not capable of managing these intermittent flows. So it's not possible for us to bring solar from, let's say, Anand to Ahmedabad. The most we can do is to put up a solar panel in this campus and electrify this whole area, but we won't be able to transmit it to long distance because the grid does not allow us to do it. It's just not capable. So investment has to be made in smart grids, in smart meters, in smart infrastructure. That investment is not happening right now in India. We're talking about, for example, in India, raising the production of solar from current 2.6 gigawatts to 100 gigawatts in 7 years' time, 4 years' time, 5 years' time. But we're not talking at the same time about the grid infrastructure that will have to be upgraded for that solar or those molecules to be transmitted from point A to the point of consumption. So both those questions, both those issues that you've raised are very important. They both have to be addressed, but one has to do with technology, and the other has to do with money. And my simple point to all of you is, neither money nor technology can hold us back, or can hold back an idea whose day has come. And the idea of shared, or let's say the idea of clean energy has come.
Thank you, sir.
I think we'll just end now. Thank you, students, for your questions, and thank you, sir, for responding. I now invite Ms. Poonam Patel, Chief Administrative Officer, IRMA, to deliver a vote of thanks.
Distinguished Speaker Shri Vikram Singh Mehta, respected Director Dr. R.C. Natarajan, esteemed dignitaries, faculty and staff colleagues, students of both the programs, guests from the media, ladies and gentlemen, it is an honor bestowed on me to propose the vote of thanks on this noteworthy occasion. On behalf of all of us here, I heartily thank our distinguished speaker, respected Shri Vikram Singh Mehta, for delivering an insightful, thought-provoking, and topical lecture. The subject, Attaining Energy Security for Rural India, has never been more relevant than in the present scenario. Sir, by sharing your thought-provoking views, you gave us a new insight into this very contemporary subject. You answered all the questions, though limited to three, with equal aplomb and cleared all the doubts we could have. I'm sure all of us here feel privileged to gain this perspective on the subject. I thank the director and director's office for all the efforts made towards organizing this program. Our deep sense of gratitude to the esteemed board members, dignitaries, special invitees, and the media for taking time out for attending this program. I thank all the faculty members and participants of Postgraduate Diploma in Rural Management and Fellow Program in Rural Management for their active participation in making this a memorable occasion. I extend thanks to all my colleagues, the Senior General Manager Estate, Shri B.C. Patel, Manager Administration, Manager Purchase, the IT Department team, and Shri P.K. Prajapati of Audiovisual for the immaculate arrangements. IRMA thanks each one of you for participating in the 5th Dr. Verghese Kurien Memorial Lecture. Thank you so much for gracing this occasion. Thank you.